الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، شر الأمور محدثاتها، كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Inshallah, tonight we start a new series and a new topic, and we will explain one of the umad or one of the major texts in عقيدة of أهل السنة والجماعة. It's a very summarized, brief text. But it's very, Allah Azza wa Jal has put the acceptance for it in the hearts of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and the ulama since then have been explaining this book. يعني هو ورقات, few pages, قليلة الكم كبيرة الكيف والمعنى, few words, but very comprehensive. This book يعني اشتهر باسم العقيدة الطحاوية. العقيدة الطحاوية. And it's called الطحاوية after عقيدة creed. And الطحاوية is after the person who wrote it. And he is الإمام أبو جعفر أحمد بن محمد بن سلامة بن سلمة بن عبد الملك الأزدي المصري الطحاوي. سمي الطحاوي نسبة إلى قرية طحا في صعيد مصر. رحت عليها في الصعيد. في الصعيد in Egypt. There's a village called طحا and he comes from there. So he's one of the فقهاء and one of the great scholars of Egypt. He's born or he was born in 239 Egypt. Some narration said 238. Okay, so we're talking about he was born about 1200 years ago. 1200 years ago. Okay. As I said, kunyatu, his nickname is Abu Ja'far. Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi. Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi. من شيوخه يونس بن عبد الأعلى. محمد بن عبد الله بن عبد الحكم. But one of the famous شيوخ he has his uncle, his maternal uncle, خاله إسماعيل المزني. إسماعيل المزني and he accompanied him for a while. He went to Syria, to Sham in 268. Okay, 268. يعني he was 30 years old. And he met القاضي أبو حازم عبد الحميد بن عبد العزيز وتفقه عليه. And then he traveled around as usual, as the ulama do, as أهل العلم do, travel to seek knowledge. مذهبه, العلماء followed مذهب. طحاوي رحمه الله, in the beginning, he was Shafi'i, as his uncle, Muzani. Okay? In the beginning, he was Shafi'i. And then later on he switched to Hanafi. Okay, he switched to Hanafi. There are many stories why he switched. One of them, that he was studying under his uncle, Muzani. And one issue, he didn't understand it. So his uncle kept يعني simplifying it so much, until he still could not get it. فيعني نهر, his uncle screamed at him, قال له لا تفلح أبدا, والله لا تفلح أبدا, أو لا يأتي منك خير. His uncle got so angry with him, he said, يعني by God you will never succeed. So he got perhaps offended, and he went and he joined the circle of knowledge of al-Qadi Abu أبي عمران الحنفي. His uncle was Shafi'i, so he left and he went to الحنفي. Okay, another story that when he was asked why he left الشافعية to الحنفية, he said, because كان كنت أرى خالي المزني يطيل النظر في كتب أبي حنيفة. He said, I used to see my uncle looking too much in the books of Abu Hanifa. Okay, it's another narration. And there are more. However, Imam al-Tahawi rahimahullah had many opinions differ from the opinions of al-Madhhab al-Hanafi, even though he belonged to al-Hanafi. Okay? Even though he belonged to al-Madhhab, he had many different opinions. ولما سئل, he was asked, why you have different opinions than al-Hanafiyya that you relate yourself to? فقال وهل من مقلد إلا غبي وهل من مقلد إلا غبي. One time in the Uraba magazine we used to issue, and inshallah it's coming back soon. The sickness يعني came between me and continuing this magazine. I wrote a short article and I included this saying in it. فهجم علي الحنفية هجوم الأسد. Until يعني those who are close-minded follow مذهب الحنفي in this area went يعني like fire on me. يعني أنا I'm calling them stupid. And I didn't call anyone stupid. أنا ناقل. I only convey. And this is الإمام الطحاوي. وهل من مقلد إلا غبي. طبعا you have to understand the saying in context. And what he's referring to, rahimahullah, he's a alim, he's a scholar, he's mujtahid. He has the ability to look into the adillah, and he has the ability to deduce the ahkam, and he had the knowledge to differentiate. Well, he doesn't need to imitate. Okay? He has the instruments to be able to decide on an opinion. Not like anyone of us, okay? So he's referring to people like him. And why I need to follow someone blindly? يَا لَيْتَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. Those who, not necessarily or only in madhab al-Hanafi, but in any madhab, those who are fanatic and close-minded and stuck with one opinion, we say, fine. If you want to imitate, imitate. Okay? But the one who really deserves to be imitated after all is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do not stand against the truth. Do not stand against the truth, especially if what you're believing or what you're following goes against the truth. Now, sometimes the dalil can handle more than one opinion, can contain more than one opinion. But sometimes the opinion is clearly against the dalil. Well, you don't need to be fanatic, especially if you are someone who has authority in the ilm, someone that people take knowledge from. You need to humble yourself to the truth, and humble yourself to the dalil, and humble yourself to the hadith. That's why Imam al-Tahawi rahimahullah Abu Ja'far, as I said and I repeated, when he was asked why he differed from Abu Hanifa or al-Hanafiyya in many opinions, he said, وَهَلْ مِنْ مُقَلِّدٍ إِلَّا غَبِيٍّ. Is there an imitator who's smart? In other words, يعني, he's saying, is there an imitator who's not stupid? But I want to say it in a nice way. Okay? That's what he said. Is there an imitator who's not stupid? But again, he refers to those who have the apparatus to be able to look into the adillah and deduce the ahkam. So this is يعني to show you, I mean, someone who changes his madhab completely is not going to be convinced with anything. رحمه الله تعالى. قال أبو سليمان زبر قال لي الطحاوي أول من كتبت عنه الحديث المزني وأخذت بقول الشافعي، فلما كان بعد سنين قدم أحمد بن أبي عمران قاضيا على مصر فصحبته وأخذت بقوله. This is يعني him saying, and perhaps this is the strongest opinion, if him himself saying it, why he changed his madhab, that he studied Shafi'i under al-Muzani, and then when Ibn Abi Imran al-Qadi came to Sham, he studied under him and he was Hanafi, or to Egypt. He has many books that he wrote, شرح مشكل الأثار، معاني الأثار، اختلاف العلماء، الشروط، مختصر أحكام القرآن، وصايا، شرح الجامع الكبير، شرح الجامع الصغير، والفرائض. All these books and others he wrote, رحمه الله تعالى. Some of his students, يوسف بن قاسم الميانجي، أبو بكر بن المقهرة، وأحمد بن عبد الوارث الزجاج، وأبو القاسم الطبراني، أبو القاسم الطبراني هو المشهور سليمان بن أحمد الطبراني، صاحب المعاجم، صاحب التفسير، تفسير الطبراني. So the مفسر of the الطبراني، إمام الطبراني، one of the students of الطحاوي. One of the students of الطحاوي. And of course الطبراني he has famous books in hadith like معجم الطبراني كبير ومعجم الطبراني الصغير. Those are famous for him and other students. قال أبو يونس ابن يونس رحمه الله about الطحاوي. كان ثقة ثبتا فقيها عاقلا لم يخلف بعد مثله. كان ثقة، ثقة trustworthy، ثبتا strong in narration، فقيها فقيه، عاقلا wise، no one like him. قال مسلمة بن قاسم كان ثقة trustworthy، جليل القدر، high status، فقيه البدن، فقيه، عالما باختلاف العلماء، he knows the opinions and the مذاهب، بصيرا بالتصنيف، he knows well in the literature. وكان يذهب مذهب أبي حنيفة، وكان شديد العصبية فيه، كان شديد العصبية فيه. قال الخليل للطحاوي كتب مصنفات في الحديث، وكان عالما بالحديث، he was scholar of hadith. As I said, he has books of hadith. قال ابن عبد البر كان من أعلم الناس بسير القبر، very well known in the history of people. But here, يعني ابن عبد البر referring to the people, يعني القوم الأحناف. الأحناف. He became Hanafi and he became very well versed in مذهب الحنفي. So, بسير القوم يعني بأبي حنيفة أصحابه. قال السمعاني كان ثقة ثبتا فقيها عالما لم يخلف منها كما قال ابن يونس. وقال الذهبي الإمام العلام الحافظ الكبير محدث الديار المصرية وفقيهها. قال من نظر في تواليف هذا الإمام علم محله من العلم وساعة معارفه. علامة. Today you find علامة. They're using the word علامة with anyone. Someone who just finished some bachelor program in fiqh or in sharia. Suddenly he's called علامة. He's or مفتي. والله يعني أنا لا أرى، I don't see that someone who has any وراء and any understanding, sincere understanding of this deen, allow anyone to call him مفتي. And he still, he just finished the bachelor program. 6 or 7 years studying Islam in the West and suddenly he's مفتي and he accept for this title. And he might be offended if he's not called Mufti. أنا أعجب. كم السلام. تجده يعني maybe he's 23, 24 years old and he calls himself Mufti. أو علامة. يعني شيء عجيب. هذا من فتن هذا الزمان. حتى يعني you become unable to distinguish between who's the Mufti and who's not. Who's العلامة and who's not. قال ابن كثير الفقيه الحنفي صاحب المصنفات المفيدة والفوائد وهو أحد الثقات الأثبات والحفاظ الجهم. If you look at these ulama, you find a lot of them from different madhab. Some Shafi'i, some Hanabila, some Maliki, and he was Hanafi. You find Shafi'iyan, even though he was Shafi'i and he became Hanafi, yet they still praise him. وهذا الحق وهذا أدب وهذا منهج أهل السنة والجماعة. This is manhaj. This is a way of the ulama. Today you find someone of no worth talking about the ulama and criticizing this alim and putting down this alim and calling tabdi'a in this alim. هو لعله يعني maybe الفاتحة he doesn't know how to recite properly. هذا غبي. This person is very stupid. You know why? And you're in trouble if your opponent on the Day of Judgment is a regular person. So imagine when you make your opponents the scholars of Islam, the ulama who have benefited this ummah. Wallahi ya akhwa, you look at those people who took and adopted such behavior, you see they contributed nothing to the deen. If they left 100 or 200 or a few hundred fatawas here and there when they died, after a couple of years, these fatawas melted and disappeared. Allah Azza wa Jal leave them with no remembrance. Subhanallah. Those who allow themselves to talk freely in the honors of the ulama. Subhanallah. And he starts talking about those who have problems. When you talk about ulama who got issues, leave it to the ulama who are at their level to talk about it. And subhanAllah, you find the ulama at their level when they want to talk about such a bid'ah, they don't mention it. وهذا نهج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Unless the mubtadi, his name, or he became famous and a lot of people following him, and he's calling to his bid'ah, and he's writing books in his bid'ah, then it becomes mandated or mandatory to warn him. But someone who's not known, and I'm helping him to become famous anyway, you know? So you find the ulama following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he didn't like something and he wanted to bring it up, he will say, مَا بَالُ أَقْوَى. What's wrong with some people? He won't say names. كما في حديث ابن اللتبية in Bukhari, where the Prophet ﷺ sent him to collect some of the zakat. So when he came back, he said, this is for you, and this part was given as a gift to me. غضب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He took the minbar, and he said, ما بال أقوام. I send them to collect the zakat. They come to say, this is for you, and this was gifted to us. أَلَّا جَلَسَ فِي بَيْتِ أُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ أَيُنْظُرُ وَأَيُهْدَى لَهِ. Why he doesn't stay in his parents' home and see if he's going to get a gift. So he saw a sallam, would not mention names. Just that is the point. Today, the jahl wal ghaba, as-salam wa rahmatullah, of those Allah na hibbana call him jarafim. Allah musta'an, as-salam lana wa lahum الهداية. توفي رحمه الله بمصر year 321 هجري. So he was born 238 and died 321. So his age was about 82 years old or 239. So this is a very brief biography of the Imam al-Tahawi that we are about to study his book. So as I said, this book is a summary of Aqeedat Ahl-Sunnah Wal-Jama'ah. And it's very important. I will mention some points that are not part of the book, but I will mention some points about the Aqeedah of Ahl-Sunnah Wal-Jama'ah. Why? Because many people, before we get into the details of the book, many of the people, or all the groups very much, claim they're Ahl-Sunnah Wal-Jama'ah. Okay? So we need to mention why the aqeedah we are following, which is an obligation of every Muslim to follow. Because the aqeedah is not something of ijtihad. The aqeedah is something that needs to be based on Allah, qala Rasul, A to Z. Okay? It's fundamental. So we will see that, and I will mention some points for you to be able to distinguish. Because even Ahl al-Bidah, even the major Mu'tazila, Al-Jahmiyya, Al-Kallabiyya, Al-Khawarij, all these groups, Al-Rawafid, all these groups claim Maturidiyya, They all claim to be Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jannah. Even though fundamental differences, they believe in, that violates the Quran and the Sunnah. So it's very important that I believe at this time, just to say Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah isn't enough. Because, yalla, everyone is Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. So it's very important for us to see the real haqeedah of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Beside the aqeedah itself, huh, as we will study it in this book, but the foundations, huh, what is it and why it should be followed. هذه عقيدة السلف الصالح. When we say عقيدة السلف الصالح, العقيدة السلفية, we are referring to the عقيدة of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and the عقيدة of the companions رضوان الله عليهم and the عقيدة of the next two generations after. That's what we talk about. When you say العقيدة السلفية, don't get stuck as they put it in your head. That is Wahhabiyya and Saudiyya. ما يهمنا. أسماء ما تهم. And who say the Salaf are only in Saudi Arabia or in Egypt or in Morocco or in Jordan. هذه عقيدة. When you see that we're calling for something violates the Quran and the Sunnah, put the names aside. يعني those out of their fanaticism and out of their close-mindedness, if they see a book by Ibn Taymiyyah, they put in the garbage. Like first of all, Ibn Taymiyyah is a human. Second of all, أنت خذ الحق. أنت if you're a man of عقيده and you're very confident of your عقيده, what you're afraid of? Look in. Because Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah رحمه الله was able to compile and organize and defend the aqeedah of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, the aqeedah al-Sahiha, the correct aqeedah, he became Rams, he became like a flag for the aqeedah al-Salafiyya. You understand? So they attack him and they make takfir on him and they make, let's see what he wrote. And al-Ajab al-Ujab, when they wanna put him down, they come to what he says in his book. And he talk about, let's say, Rawafid. And Rawafid say, ABC. So they come and they bring you ABC. And they say, you see, he said this in his books. Oh, what he's saying, they say. So remove they say about the people of Bid'ah and the people of innovation. And they bring what they say. And they say, he said it in his books. Al-Iyadu Billah, yani min al-Fud. Adak. And this is not the behavior and the manners of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. قال الإمام الطحاوي في عقيدته. So now we will start with the book and then I'll talk about those issues. هذا ذكر بيان عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة على مذهب فقهاء الملة أبي حنيفة النعمان بن ثابت الكوفي وابي يوسف يعقوب بن ابراهيم الانصاري وابي عبد الله محمد بن الحسن الشيباني رضوان الله عليهم اجمعين ما يعتقدون من اصول الدين ويدينون به رب العالمين. هذا يعني هي رحمه الله from the beginning said هذا ذكر بيان عقيده اهل السنه والجماعه. يعني this what he's about to tell us in his book is a reminder and a mentioning of the عقيده of what أهل السنة والجماعة believe. Okay, what أهل السنة والجماعة believe. And you see, when we talk about العقيدة, الاعتقاد fall into, can carry two meanings. إما عقد القلب نفسه, because عقيدة, an اعتقاد, if you break it down to the root, عقادة. عقد is to tie, to make a knot. فهذه العقيدة الاعتقاد could be called on the belief of the heart. The heart is stuck in this belief, like a knot, tied. خلاص, this is what I believe. هذه عقيدة. And also could be called on the principles themselves. فهذا اعتقاد أهل السنة والجماعة. On the principles themselves and the basics that the people of أهل السنة والجماعة believe in. So very much that's the i'tiqad. So he said, this is remembrance or reminding or mentioning of aqidat ahl sunnah wal jama'ah ala madhhab fuqaha al millah, on the madhhab of the fuqaha of this deen. And he mentioned Abu Hanifa rahimahullah and his two students, Abu al-Hasan al-Shaybani and Abu Yusuf. But obviously this is not the aqidah of Abu Hanifa alone and his students. Okay? This is the aqidah of the Shafi'i and Malik and Ahmed, the aqidah of Thawri and Ibn Rahawi, Qa'anabi, the aqidah of Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, the aqidah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? But again, because of him being Hanafi. وما يعتقدون, he said, وما يعتقدون في أصول الدين ويدينون به رب العالمين. And whatever they believe in from أصول الدين. أصول الدين, the basics of the deen. Some of the ulama call anything related to العقيدة أصول. ماشي. So when they say أصول الدين, the basics of the deen, يعني the foundations, they refer to العقيدة. But الراجح, and as Ibn Qayyim and Shaykh al-Islam, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, established that الأصول is not only limited to العقيدة العلمية, which is the belief. It also involves the العقيدة العملية. فمثلا أصول الإيمان الستة, إيمان بالله وملائكته, هذه عقيدة. فصم فهل العلم said أصول الدين only has to do with the belief, with the عقيدة. Another opinion that أصول الدين entails both العقيدة and فقه. So عندك أصول أصول الإسلام الخمس, الصلاة, الشهادتين, الصلاة, الصيام. فهذا يعني difference between the علماء when they talk about أصول الدين. But usually when they say أصول الدين they refer to العقيدة. بس هي عندك اعتقادية علمية, يعني what you believe in, knowledge, and also تعبدية, which is practice. Okay, some of the علماء say it's only عقيدة and some say no, the way we worship Allah Azza wa Jalla is part of أصول الدين. One of the things that someone might criticize or might bring up is why we need to study this. I mean, all the Muslims are say la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and they all in tawheed. And what's the big deal? And why you guys talk about it? Some people make fun of those who teach al-aqidah. They say they talk about tawheed and Allah is one. Who said, "Inta aslan, inta you know that al-aqidah is only Allah is one"? If that's what al-aqidah is, then we don't really need to teach. But al-aqidah is way more than that. And second, one of the answers to those people is to say that the significance of the ilm is based on al-ma'lum. How important certain knowledge is based on what it's related to. And what is more significant than Allah Azza wa Jalla? When we talk about Tawheed, the significance of certain knowledge is based on what the topic it discusses. And Al-Aqidah discusses Allah Azza wa Jalla, talks about Allah. So what's more important than that? Now what is more important? Tawheed or Salah? Is there Salah without Tawheed? Tawheed without Salah? Some of the opinions, fi mashiyati. The one who doesn't pray, fi mashiyati. If he dies on la ilaha illallah but doesn't pray, one of the opinions, if Allah wills, he punishes him, if Allah wills. So he has a chance. أما سوى داعش بذات التوحيد إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به. الله does not forgive الشرك. And he forgives anything beside. That's if the person dies on shirk. أما if he commits shirk in life and repents, Allah forgives him. Okay, he's sincere. So the point is, if we say, why you teach people how to pray? It's not important. Why you teach people how to give zikr? Why you teach people how to make hajj? If someone says that, people will look at him and say, what's wrong with you? Huh? Like you come to school and say, why are you teaching my kids in the school salah? It's not important. They'll say you're crazy. But the tawheed, isn't it more important than salah? So why are you putting doubt and criticizing, studying tawheed? So very important. The best thing in the Quran is tawheed. The best thing, the greatest thing in the book of Allah, the ayat that talk about tawheed. And the greatest of that is when Allah Azza wa Jal talks about himself. When Allah talks about himself. That's why قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. You know the significance of this surah, ثلث القرآن. Very important to understand this fact. Tawheed is a must. We must teach it. As well, since we're mentioning this, let's talk about those who say we only need to learn about Tawheed. You have this group. They say we should only learn about Tawheed. So you come to talk about the Salah as well? لا. So you need to talk about Tawheed. Come to talk about history? لا. Only Tawheed. You talk about the heart? No. Only Tawheed. Again, we're falling in that circle of stupidity with those people. Some people, as I heard, criticizing my lectures and this and that, and he should talk about Tawheed, why he's talking about Salah, why he's talking about this, and why he's talking about heart. And you're going to give me a schedule. And who told you we didn't talk about Tawheed? And I can't go into any lectures of mine. And if you really understand the meaning of Tawheed, you will see it and hear it in every lecture I give. Because the bottom line is, and I want to connect you with Allah Azza wa Jal. Maybe I don't go in details about the principle of Tawheed, because that has its own lectures and its own setting. But the bottom line is, when I talk about, I spent, 2 years talking about the names and attributes of Allah, that's not Tawheed. I have to open a book of Tawheed to say, what is the names and attributes of Allah? One of the fundamentals part of Tawheed. So, some people. Anyway, the very first series I taught since I came back from Philadelphia was Aqeedah. Allah understand. Let's see the Aqeedah, as I told you, principles about the Aqeedah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jamaah that you will not find in other Aqeedah, even though they claim they're Ahl Sunnah wal Jamaah. Because now everyone claims Ahl Sunnah wal Jamaah. But I want to know, this guy is attacking this guy, and this guy attacks this guy, and this guy says he's Ahl Sunnah wal Jamaah, and this guy says he's Ahl Sunnah wal Jamaah. And I cannot sit to this guy for 2 years to ask him about his aqeedah and details, and to this guy, And I don't have the capacity or the knowledge to tell. Even if he tells me his aqeedah and this guy tells me, I still don't have the knowledge to distinguish. So how I can? Because there is iman mujman, and there is iman mufassil. Yeah. There is iman, when we talk about iman, there is general iman, which means everyone is required to know, every Muslim, in general. And the person with these issues will not be excused for his ignorance. But we cannot say, make this statement, and leave it wide open like that. Because some people could be excused with those general principles of Islam because they were never taught. I met people in college raised يعني to Muslim parents. They didn't even know Fatiha. When I come to, oh, this guy is supposed to know the major principles of Islam, so he's out of Islam. But in general, their major principles of Islam, or the comprehensive Iman as they call it, everyone very much should know. There are some people, most people will not be excused. But some people will be excused because maybe they didn't have a sheikh in their town, maybe they didn't have knowledge in their town. You find that. Muslim, a lot of Muslim areas in the world, and that's because of our own shortcomings. تقصير في الدعوة. We're not doing what we're supposed to do. They don't know the major, the basics of the world. So when we say comprehensive Iman, Iman Mujmal, then every Muslim very much needs to know something like Allah is one. And He's the only one who needs to be worshipped. Something like Allah sent the messengers, Allah sent books. Every Muslim should know that. And then you have the Iman al-Mufassal, the detailed Iman. And this is Fard Kifaya. The details of al-Fiqh. The details of Ahkam al-Mawarith, for example. The details of al-Iman, issues of al-Qadar, this and that. Not everyone is capable even to understand. So we say, there's a group of the Ummah must know this. Those are the ulama. They need to teach it to others. Okay? Very important. So most Muslims, if I sit to explain al-aqeedah, or as A and B individuals that we give the example, if those people sit to teach them the aqeedah, he will still not be able to tell who's right and who's wrong. So now I will share with you some points I put down of the principles that it will help you to distinguish without needing or without the need to know the details. يعني الخوارج, when it comes to the Iman al-Mufassal, they say everyone is responsible to know about every detail in the deen. Muslim is born and die, and he still maybe he never opened the Mus'haf. Maybe he doesn't even know how to read. How are you going to learn? Maybe might be an area where there's no activities. And the UC masajid. Did. The Imam hardly coming to lead the Salah. Did. And they have potential and they have space and lazy. And they're getting paid with thousands and thousands of dollars. If Allah Azza wa Jal chose for me to be in such town, and there is no da'wah, no ilm, and you see the da'wah now is active and all that. 50, 60 years ago, the Ummah was dead of the deen. Look at videos of events happened 50 years ago, or even like movies and in the Arab world especially. Look at the way they're dressed. Look how the street, the women and the men, and this beard thing is something really new. The beard thing in the Muslim world is really something new, especially in the Arab world. The hijab disappeared due to the colonization of the Muslim countries, very much this, even the Arabic language. Some Muslim nations, Arab nations today, cannot even talk Arabic. So you have to understand the whole circumstance. All right. So let's put the dots, as they say, نقاط على الحرف. The dots over the letters. Let's make it comprehensible. When we say Aqeedah Salafiyya, we refer to Aqeedah Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah, the true Aqeedah. Some people today, as I said, they hear Salafi, Wahhabi. Wahhabi, you call him Wahhabi. He called himself Wahhabi. That's one. Second, why you are so angry? If he wants to follow Aqeedah Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah, why you're so angry that whatever he calls himself. Now what do we care about? The names don't matter to us. You want to call yourself Sufi, you want to call yourself this, tell me what you believe in. As we established in the previous book. Because today people confuse. A lot of people, really, a lot of people, and I am a person. He says he calls himself one thing, and his aqeedah is in opposite of what he calls himself. Because خلاص people today love names. أنا والله شافعي أنا this أنا people love me. أنا سلفي أنا صوفي خلاص people love names. But if you really talk to him and see what he believes in, huh? You realize, you know what he's really not what he's called, what he thinks he is. Okay, so let's put the names aside. Okay, yes, there are many people who call themselves names and they know what they're calling themselves and they believe in those principles. But I'm talking about the mainstream people. Huh? خلاص, he's born into a family that followed طريق النقشبندية or whatever. But he went to college and he studied the Sunnah and he studied right and he went to Imam and he learned. لا خلاص يعني okay. This person, يعني whatever he calls himself by the name, what he really believes is something different. So let's put the names aside. Don't tell me Saudi and Wahhabi and Sufi. Huh? This is not. إحنا أنا I'm talking about عقيدة. Whoever believes in this عقيدة will fall under عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة. So when you use the term Salaf al-Salih, as I said, I'm not referring to the people in Saudi Arabia. But Saudi Arabia has Sufis and has Maturidis and has all these aqeedas. And I refer to the Prophet ﷺ, to the Sahaba, and to the two next generations after them that the Prophet ﷺ himself praised. And I'm saying that those are Salaf al-Salih. Whoever in their footsteps is from Salaf al-Salih. So just the fact you come and you say, I'm Salafi, it doesn't mean anything to me. Okay? Very important to establish this. So when I use the word Salaf here, don't run away. Just wait until I explain. Salaf, I'm referring to. Salaf means what? Those lived and died in the past. Which of the past I want to follow? My Salaf, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Sahaba, and the next two generations. Tabi'in, Tabi'in, Tabi'in. I look at their aqeedah. I look what they believed and I follow. Can anyone blame me on that? Okay? Ya akhi, I'm not Salafi. And I'm not Ikhwani. And I'm not all these names. Mubtadi'u, Qutbi, Khawarij, Kada, Kada. Names, yani. أقسم بالله العظيم. Some people use these names and he cannot tell you one thing about what these names or these people believe. One thing. They're floating all over the place. Again, let's put the names aside and let's see what their aqidah was. Inta, will you be happy if we both follow the aqidah of Abu Bakr? It'll be okay. Isn't Abu Bakr promised al-Jannah? I don't think you can disagree with me. Will you be happy if we follow the aqidah of Shafi'i? Or Malik? Or Ibn Hanbal? Or Abu Hanifa? No. خالص. إحنا we're going to study their aqidah. Put the names as I gave, as I told you. They come to Ibn Taymiyyah. His book's garbage, don't read. I met people, their shuyukh or the imams in the masajid where they used to go, used to forbid them from reading books. Not only Ibn Taymiyyah, but mainly Ibn Taymiyyah, but books, period. He said the only book you're allowed to read is the Quran. This is slavery. So what are you afraid of? Establish the foundations in him, establish the right thing. Let him know what's right and what's wrong. There is no way you can control him not to read for the rest of his life. You cannot put him, this is not like those... yeah, something like that. Those Mormons do. Yeah. How they create their own villages and that's it. People can't leave. Or those... Scientist or whatever, what they call it?
Scientology.
Yeah. This is absurd. In Islam, don't do that. You establish foundations, right? خلاص. يعني الصحابة Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم built them right. And then after that, they spread all over the world. They came across every philosophy and every manhaj and every religion. We don't hear that the Sahabi became following Aristotle. They weren't affected by the Zoroastrians, those Persians. They didn't get affected by Christians. Because they were established right. They knew what they need to believe. They knew what they need to accept. And what they need to reject. That's what we need to do. That's what we need to do. So when we talk about العقيدة, إحنا عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة. عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة. هي عقيدة before I continue, it's not عقيدة ابن تيمية وابن القيم وابن أحمد بن حنبل only. Now I want to emphasize this point. Why when you talk about Aqidah you want to study their books? First of all, I'm not. Now I'm studying Aqidah al-Tahawi. Second, those people, and Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, in his time, came the fitan of al-Aqidah. What happened when the Muslim empire, especially al-Ma'mun, Umayyin, Khalifa was al-Ma'mun, معتصم توكل المأمون imported Islam spread to Europe, okay, to other cultures. So they imported the books. They imported the books of Yunan, of the Greek, and the Roman, philosophers, and they translated. Those are philosophical. Ideologies, not based on religion. So many people of the Muslims who were not firm with their aqidah got influence. Just like you see today. You find him coming from back home, mashallah, Quran and Salah. He goes to school, he studies whatever, psychology, philosophy. Suddenly he becomes akhuna questioning the Quran and this one. He was not established, right? So when they brought them, and many people, they got translated, and many people read, even in Ma'mun himself adopted this. Which is the famous fitna of Khalq al-Qur'an, the creation of the Qur'an. And Imam Ahmed wanted to respond. Now there is a fitna, and I cannot just stay quiet about it. Okay? There was a big movement to the bid'ah, calling to the principles that violate the deen of Islam, the aqidah of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. At the time of Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahum. So he had to argue with them, he had to fight them, he had to refute them. He was well-rounded, he organized ideas, he organized the knowledge, and Allah Azza wa Jal put the acceptance for it and got spread. But he didn't come up with a new aqidah. You're talking about Ibn Taymiyyah, you're talking about Qarn al-Tasi'. 800, 900 years after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He didn't come with a new aqidah. Okay? So when we say aqidah Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, we're not referring to aqidah of Ibn Taymiyyah as they want people to believe. That's why they call the people who he refuted their principles and their aqaid, they consider him kafir. They consider Ibn Taymiyyah kafir, Ibn al-Qayyim kafir, Ibn Kathir kafir, al-Dhahabi kafir. Why? Because they refuted their aqaid. So very important. That's why one of their behaviors, فأهل البدع, whenever you say Ibn Taymiyyah, خلاص, they cross you off. طب, hear what I'm gonna say? لا. Anything comes from Ibn Taymiyyah, باطل. طب, this is not justice. يعني الله عز وجل in the Quran says, ومن أهل الكتاب من انت منه بدينار يؤديه إليه. ومنهم من انت منه منهم من تأمنه بقنطار يؤديه إليك ومنهم من تأمنه بدينار لا يؤديه إليك إلا ما أنت عليه قائم. طب الله عز وجل mentions the people, the Jews here. He said some of them, if you trust him with a, يعني القنطار is 12,000 dirham. If you trust him with a big amount of money, he will give it back to you. And some of them, if you trust him with one dinar, he won't give it until you keep hammering him and begging him. But the point is Allah Azza wa Jal, out of justice, and this is aqeedah of Ahli Sunnah wa Jama'ah, out of justice, and I'll take from you the good, and I leave the bad. أما to cross someone completely out, that shows fanatism, that shows ta'assub, shows close-minded, and shows that you're scared. That's why Ibn Hudhayfa, Ibn al-Yamah, rahimahullah, رضي الله عنه, he said, خذ الحق من كافر أو جاهل. من كافر أو فاجر وحذر زيقة الحكيم. Take the truth even if it comes from كافر or فاجر, and be aware of the mistake of the wise. حق أحب إلينا, more beloved to us the truth than our parents and our wealth. That's our عقيدة. And also from our عقيدة that the knowledge or the truth is not known by the people or for the people. حق لا يعرف بالرجال إنما الرجال هم الذين يعرفون بالحق. And then because so and so, خلاص, whatever he says got to be the truth. He will be known for the truth. If he's saying the truth, then he will be known for it. And the truth is not known for him. ماشي? This is our aqeedah, which will protect you from being fanatic to someone. Now we're only fanatic to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. كما قال الإمام مالك, he was teaching in al-Haram, Madani. He said, كل يؤخذ منه ويرد عليه إلا صاحب هذا القبر. We take from everyone and we reject from everyone except the man in that grave. And he pointed to the grave of the Prophet. هذه عقيدة. ماشي. So we're not fanatic. لا to ابن تيمية ولا to ابن القيم ولا to أحمد ولا to الشافعي. We take. Whoever says the truth, we take. But we will guarantee to you and we will tell you with full confidence that Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim and before them Imam Ahmad, they were on the aqeedah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is no doubt about it. Aqeedah al-Salaf al-Salih, this aqeedah we're talking about, the student doesn't choose it out of desires. Like madhahib, like fiqh. Allah na ilaha illa madhahib al-Hanafi. He goes with him. You know, in the Muslim world, a lot of people adopt certain madhab, especially big names. He adopts certain madhab because that was the class open in the college where he got accepted. Yeah. Who was his whole life studying under a Shafi'i. This happened to some, and they mentioned some of the ulama. So he started college. He was studying as a child and growing up, and now he started regular education in a college like Al-Azhar. So he goes to Al-Azhar. He starts Sharia school. And there Al-Azhar, there are different departments, different madhab. So he wants to go, let's say, Maliki. But really the number of students registered in Maliki fiqh, not many, but mainly they're Shafi'i or Maliki. They say, we're not going to open a whole section for you. خلاص, go to Hanafi. And خلاص, they start there and he finish Hanafi. This is shahwa. And second, يعني, to show you it's not very serious man. Now when it comes to al-aqidah, it's not. Al-aqidah is one. And you don't follow it because, wallah, and I like the principles of Shafi'i. Or I like the fiqh of al-Hanabi. Or I like the ulama of al-Hanafi. Aqidah is one. So you choose it based on the truth. Al-Aqidah we will follow and we're studying is al-Aqidah al-Rabbaniya al-Wahida. يعني إيه؟ يعني مصدرها الله عز وجل. It comes from Allah. So when we say our Aqidah is this, I better be ready to show you proof from Allah that he said this. Or a proof from the book of Allah or the messenger of Allah that he said this. It's not a matter of I think. Imagine? Very important. يعني, as we will see later, some of those Ahlul Kalam, And the people who followed these translated books and that, they tell you the first wajib, إحنا the first wajib, into how a person becomes Muslim. لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. So the really the first wajib is what? Shahad. To accept Allah as the one Lord who deserves to be worshipped. Those who studied these books of philosophy, now is this so simple or what? Tell someone the first wajib, you as a person, someone walks in right now, Christian or Jew or lost or whatever, and he says, I want to become Muslim. What is the first thing we tell him to do? Takes the shahada. So those who got influenced by the Greek and by the Romans and by and the Yunnan and all that, they said the first wajib is an-nadhar. The first wajib is reflection. So you reflect. Go to the Everglades, and reflect. Go to the mountains and reflect. And then eventually, your mind, because that's all they got, your mind will guide you to God. Really? This mind can guide you to Allah, but if it's clean, and how can I come to someone who's 30 or 40 or 20 or 15 or 25, who's been hammered with the corruption of the world in his mind, in al-aqidah, in believing in what God is. This guy tells him there is no God, and this guy, and then I tell him, go reflect. Who his mind and his heart is infected. Then you have another group who told you, la, the first wajib is قصد النظر. Yes, sir. طب أنت you come to عام you tell قصد النظر. First wajib on you is قصد to intend to reflect. What are you talking about? But some of them went further. And those groups I'm telling you claim to be Islam. Claim to be Aqidat Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Some of them went further to say the first wajib is what? Shak. First wajib is to doubt Allah. They said that's the first wajib. To doubt Allah, so eventually you'll find Him. يعني الحاد عقيدة الحاد كفر زندق. طب بالله عليك أنا I come to someone who doesn't know any, and I tell him choose. The first thing is to say لا إله إلا الله, or to reflect, or to intend to reflect, or to doubt. Which one you will choose? Which is the simplest? This عقيدة. You will find one of the special things about Aqidah Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah الصحيحة, the correct one, it's simple. Now if you open books of Aqidah of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah and you see very complicated terminology, why? It's because the people of Bidah created those terms. So Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah had to refute them by using them. Understand? Whoever has no basis. يعني when the Ash'ari comes to you, this is one of the Aqaid, and he tells you, Allah is not inside the world, and Allah is not outside the world, Allah is not on top of the world, and Allah is not the bottom of the world, Allah is not on the right, Allah is... But then you come to someone who's simple, and you start telling him, he wants to do what? He wants to tell you that Allah is not contained in space. طب الله uses the words all this thing you into a simple person. How are you gonna believe if it's so complicated? Imagine we wanna teach Aqidah in middle school or elementary school. And then we talk about Allah is not over and it's not bottom, it's not right and it's not inside and it's not. That you could use the heck out of it. Seriously, 7 and 8 years old, what are you gonna understand? أما شوف الله عز وجل when he talks about himself, الرحمن على العرش استوى. There's a throne, Allah has a throne, and Allah upon it. خلاص انتهينا. The Sahaba, when they heard this, خلاص. Immediately it sunk in. They didn't need to ask, what do you mean? They didn't ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, does that mean Allah is on top? Or Allah on the bottom? Or Allah inside? They didn't ask, is the throne inside the world or outside? كلام. So why Ahl al-Sunnah will mention these things? Because they have to mention them, because these people of Bid'ah introduced them, so they have to refute them. You understand? أَمَّا عَقِيدَتْنَا عَقِيدَةَ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ It's very simple. And you will see Imam al-Tahawi. Very basic. Huh? Very basic. As we will see when you study. So عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة عقيدة ربانية. عقيدة ربانية. يعني مصدرها الله. It's foundations and proofs from Allah. From the Quran, from the Sunnah. But why? Are you saying other aqaid, they use other resources? You got that right. There is no other aqeedah than aqeedah salafiyya, aqeedah sahiha. There's no other aqeedah. Relies mainly on Allah and the Quran and the Sunnah for its very fundamental beliefs. Why? Who tells me? True, because it's made up. And actually, in Islam, those who claim to be Muslims and got corrupted in Aqeedah, very much other than the Aqeedah Salafiyya, Sahiha, the correct, and we said again, when we say Salaf, we mean, mainly when we talk about Aqeedah, Prophet ﷺ, Sahaba, next two generations, and those who follow them. So I want you to take out, to start understanding the word Salaf from different perspective, to be fair. There are many people out there today, they claim to be Salaf and they're not Salaf. So let's not get stuck with them. And there are many people out there who say they're on the Aqeedah of Salaf al-Salih, and they are. We have great ulama. But then I want you to make yourself more objective and think what I meant in the beginning. So العقيدة السلفية, if you ask me, when did it start? Now let's forget about the prophets and the messages before. I tell you, it came from and started with the prophets. Any other عقيدة who claim to be أهل السنة والجماعة, we can literally determine a date when they started. We can say in such and such year, so and so started and started calling for such and such aqeedah that no one, he cannot prove that anyone before him from the Prophet ﷺ until his time said anything that he said. Which tells me what? It's false. It's not, aqeedah is not something that can be discovered 200 years later. Aqeedah, the Prophet ﷺ must have come with the aqeedah. Nashi? And you look at other aqaid and you see. And some of the examples, we said the source of our aqeed, the aqeed al-salafiyya, aqeed al-ahl al-sunnah wal-jama'ah, is the Quran and the Sunnah. But what the source of the other aqaid, those new aqaid? Their source, poetry. Wisdoms, sayings, يعني quotations of great people. اليونان, the Greek, the Romans, philosophy. That's where they got it from. It was foreign to the Muslim world until they brought it in. They cannot trace it back to the Prophet or the Sahaba. Okay? And on and on. The Aqeedah of Salaf, الوحي. The revelation. قيل, it's been said, أهل السنة في أهل الإسلام مثل أهل الإسلام في سائر الملل. أهل السنة who stick to the Aqeedah, the correct Aqeedah in Islam is like the Muslims in the rest of the world. You get that? The Muslim group that stick to the right aqeedah, to the rest of the Muslims, with all their corrupted aqaid, is similar to the Muslim ummah amongst the rest of the ummah. Which means what? The whole ummah isn't on the same aqeedah. That's obviously why we have to discuss this. عقيدة أهل السنة الصحيحة, the correct عقيدة, عقيدة إجماعية. إيش يعني؟ يعني it's not called or related to an individual. هي عقيدة, the only individual it can be called after is محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. يعني we don't say العقيدة, this is عقيدة عمرية. And we say this is the aqidah of Umar bin Khattab, but we don't say Umariya, like they did with Imam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab. They said Wahhabis. Who was Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab? He brought a new aqidah and bring a new aqidah. Allah Ya Akbar, if you look in his books, you will not find other than mainly his books. Qala Allah, qala Rasul. He brings you, he says, and we Muslims should believe in this, and he brings you ayah, brings you hadith. Brings you a saying of the Sahaba. Then how we can cross him out if that's what he calls for? Many people who used to attack the Wahhabi, as they call it, which is, when it comes to the Aqidah, it's the right Aqidah. Who, when they were given the books of Imam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, and you know the time he came, you know what was happening to the Muslims when he came to invite to his da'wah. They were shirk in Mecca and Medina. Shirk. They were worshipping awliya. They were worship. They did not know what tawheed was. So many people who were attacking him, they were given his book or his books without the covering, without a name. And when they were read, they said, yeah, this is perfect. This is what Islam. As I said, we take the truth from whoever says it, and we reject the false from whoever says it. I don't care who he is. And we know everything came from the Prophet, and it's the truth. So he's the only one we cannot reject, because no batil came out of him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So aqeedah al-salafiyya wa aqeedah al-sunnah al-jama'ah, aqeedah ijma'iyya, meaning it's the aqeedah of the Muslims supposed to follow. It's not after a person. The other aqaid, after a person, after a group. فمثلا معتزلة. معتزلة, we can determine and pinpoint the date when it started. Now you say, someone will say, what are you talking about معتزلة? This is old. And that you little you know, they are people who adopt al-aqidah al-i'tizaliyya wa aqidah al-i'tizal today, and they have followers and they have schools in the Muslim world. Mu'tazila today, and they have satellite channels, and they have, you want to tell me don't they exist? And I'm not talking about something happened and it's done or did. So if you look at Mu'tazila, you see that Al-Ja'd ibn Dirham started. And then Al-Jahm ibn Safwan, his student, spread it, Al-Jahmiyyah and all that. We have a specific date when that started. So it's impossible to be the correct aqidah. It's impossible that all these sahaba and all these ulama did not know what the true aqidah, and suddenly Al-Ja'd ibn Dirham figured it out, Eureka. And what he calls for is something that they didn't call before. So obviously he's coming with something new. So if we accept what he said, we say the Prophet ﷺ failed to deliver the message. He did not complete it. And Allah says what? Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum. Today I have completed for you your religion. So if someone gonna come with something new in the aqidah that the Prophet didn't discuss, the Quran didn't discuss, he is clearly violating the Book of Allah.
One of the things he came up with, as we mentioned, Allah never talked to موسى. لم يكلم الله موسى تكليما ولم يتخذ الله إبراهيم خليلا. Allah didn't take Ibrahim as خليل. Allah didn't talk to موسى. But the Quran say otherwise. Now he's not only coming with something that is not mentioned here or there. He's coming with something opposite of what's mentioned here and there. Like, how can I accept his aqidah? Impossible. الأشعرية أبو الحسن الأشعري. And شوف الأشاعرة they fanatic and they persist to continue on what they believe even though it's violating the aqidah, aqidah أهل السنة والجماعة. Even though أبو الحسن الأشعري رحمه الله at the end he went back to aqidah أهل السنة before he died. He put the principles for their aqidah, which was corrupted. Then at the end of his life, he went back to aqidah al-sahab. And they continue after him, calling themselves after him. And he himself denounced that aqidah. Subhanallah, al-ama. Al-ama basira. Then you have aqaid, kalam al-nafsi, and these philosophical terminology, we can pinpoint when these things started. Yeah, sure. They talk about where Allah is. Where Allah? As I said, the example, it's not up, it's not down, it's not right, it's not left, it's not inside, it's not. Prophet ﷺ, they bring him a woman, a slave woman. One of the Sahaba had a slave woman, he smacked her, he slapped her in the face. So he regretted, he took her to the Prophet ﷺ to tell him what he should do. So the Prophet ﷺ asked her, where is Allah? This is a slave woman who knows nothing. Simple human being. Where is Allah? She said. She pointed up. And to ask a child, where is Allah? Points up. Because it's the simplest thing. The fitrah will take you. Inta, when you're in stress, forget Muslims, not Muslim. When you're in stress and you wanna ask God for something, do you look like that? Look. So the Prophet ﷺ asks her, where is Allah? She points up. Who am I? He asked her. She said, Rasulullah. So he tells the Sahabi, da'aha fa'innaha mu'atiqha fa'innaha muslima, mu'mina. Free her. She's a believer. Simple. Imagine the Prophet. Where is Allah? What do you mean by that? Up? No. Inside? هذه very simple عقيدة. عقيدة أهل السنة. Okay. So all these يعني عقائد that came about. Just I collected some names. الشافعي، المزني، الصفرائيني، الأصبهاني، أبو حنيفة، الشيباني، student. أبو يوسف student, طحاوي مالك ابن القاسم student, ابن الحسن ابن عبد البر students of مالك, الإمام أحمد and his followers, الشوكاني الصنعاني ابن الوزير. Those last three, الشوكاني والصنعاني ابن الوزير, were زيدية. زيدية one of them, طوائف السنة but with تشيع, but they're still with the سنة إن شاء الله. Okay, their opinion, one of their opinion is Ali should have been the Khalifa. But they don't curse the Sahaba, they don't say Abu Bakr kafir. لا, they say they're great Sahaba. يعني they're on bid'ah. But we don't take them, compare them to Rawafid. عليهم من الله ما يستحقون. But those, when they studied عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة, they left الزيدية. الشوكاني والصنعاني. But all these names, مالك والشافعي وأبو حنيفة وأحمد and their students, كلهم على عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة. Now someone will come and say, oh, but Ibn Hajar, they say he's Ash'ari. This and that, these names. And we say, again, we establish the foundation, the rule we started with. طيب Ibn Hajar, طيب ما they are better than Ibn Hajar. Who are not Ash'ari. So why you want to stick with them? With names, why don't we stick with the truth? Now, any names you're going to bring me, when I'm bringing you, Malik, Ahmed, Abu Hanifa, and Shafi. anyone you will bring, huh, most probably going to be one of their followers. But let's stop at them and look behind. Okay? Yani let's, if we draw a line, let's look at the first one that brought up this thing of any aqeedah and put a line on it, historically. And look at everyone before him. Did anyone before him believe in that? They can't prove it. So now you want me to take someone who came 300, 400, 500 years later, and this guard or this guard, the rest, the ulama, the thousands, hundreds of thousands of ulama, including the Sahaba and the Prophet ﷺ, because Ibn Hajar, who came way later. And this is not dalil. And now you're being fanatic to a person. And our aqeedah, is the truth, not a person. Very simple to refute. Are we gonna come and most of the ulama were ashab? So where you get that? That's one. Second, there's a big difference between someone who makes mistakes when he gives the meaning of the names of Allah or the attributes of Allah, and someone who tells you, I am Ash'ari, believes in the principles. Complete difference. And I might be teaching aqidah and make a mistake. Mashi? And the mistake I make puts me with, is something in Mu'tazila believes in. It makes me Mu'tazili. وشوف أهل السنة والجماعة الصحيحة, they do not discard the books of Ibn Hajar, for example. Even if we're gonna assume and accept his Ash'ar. Well, the most important book, perhaps, in explaining the meanings of the hadith, is شرح ابن حجر من البخاري, فتح الباري, في شرح صحيح البخاري. We أهل السنة والجماعة, عقيدة, أصحاب العقيدة السنة. We, this is a reference. A student of knowledge cannot be a student of knowledge without this book in his library. You know? Well, we say, we take the truth from it, and whatever is violating, we discard. And we make excuse for Ibn Hajar. Not make takfir on him. No, we make excuse for him. خلص, هو human. Not any one of us. The ulama. ماشي؟ So I'm telling you, Shafi'i, Ahmad, Abu Hanifa, Malik, and their students, Shukani after that, hundreds of years later, they have that aqeedah. Why you want to go to another aqeedah? You know what they say? And the Sha'ir, for example, they say, Ahmed was a Sha'ir. Malik was a Sha'ir. And this, and what they look for? Stop looking for maybe weak narrations and words that can be taken out of context. That's what they use as their proof. أما the words that clearly coming out of their mouth, طب الأشعري says that. He says Allah is not over the arsh. He says Allah is الرحمن على العرش استوى. He says استولى. استولى to take over. That's the meaning of استولى. Why he says that? Because he says if I say Allah is over the throne, that means I limit Allah to a space. Huwa, his intention is good. There is no doubt, but he went so far. Allah himself says, "على العرش استوى." Any human being, normal human being, will understand. Any Arab person, or anyone who knows the Arabic language, "استوى" means to be upon, to rise over. That's what the Sahaba understood. That's why they didn't ask what it means. So, into now, you want to raise Allah and say Allah is not contained in a place, which is Allah isn't. And the fact we saying Allah is over or rising over his throne, we're not saying Allah is contained. Into you put in your idea that Allah is like a human. So if I'm rising or I'm on top of the chair, and Allah is over the throne, that means Allah is in a place, not just the way I am contained in a place. No, we didn't say that. Into you allowed your mind to go further. So now you want to raise Allah over the idea in your head. You put in your head. So how are we going to get out of that? He still used. Stawa means stawla. So now he put Allah lower than what he's supposed to be. What he meant to raise him, he put him down. How? استولى means to take back. So now he's saying what? Allah took back the throne. Which means Allah lost the throne and now he got it back. And when I come, when you say القائد فلان بن فلان استولى على الجزيرة. إيش يعني؟ يعني نقول الصليبيون دخلوا بلاد الإسلام واستولوا على القدس. The Crusades entered the lands of Islam and استولوا on Jerusalem. That means they took it away from the Muslims or the ones before who were holding. So Muslim Salah al-Din comes and استولى على بيت المقدس. He took it back from the Crusade. So when we say Allah استولى on the throne, that means Allah took back the throne. And the only way you take back something, if you lost it in the first place. So he meant to raise Allah. Now he put Allah as there's a competitor with Allah. When does this happen? When you put, you want to use your mind for al-aqidah. You start making up your own stuff. Stick to the Quran and the Sunnah. And this is the aqidah of Ahl al-Salaf, of Salaf al-Salih, aqidah of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. It is very simple. There is no doubt about it. They will come and they will argue. We say our aqidah is very simple. It's very clear. And to open some of the books of this aqidah, you will not understand a word. Go open the books of Ibn Arabi, Hallaj, and these people. You will have no idea what they're talking about. How is this to everyone? How is this deen to everyone? If the aqeelah cannot understand, Allah understand. So these are very basic lines for aqeelah Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah Sahiha that we will be studying inshaAllah. It was important to discuss it and introduce this these lectures with. And inshaAllah, next week, we start with the book itself. I started today, but we start with the text itself and comment wherever we need to comment and explain. قُلْ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ جزاكم الله خير. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.